Welcome to Calm 100, Mass Media and Society. I'm your instructor, Catherine Clinch. It's a little known fact that, like every other mother, I'm psychic. I can see the future. I can tell the truth, see what the truth is. It annoys my kids to no end, but I know when they're telling me the truth. I know when something's wrong. And hopefully, as I'm going to show you today, I know what the future holds for mass media and society. Before we get started, and we're going to be talking about mobile, transmedia, and the cold, hard facts about the future and present situation in mass media. Before we get started, we have some bookkeeping. As always, there are three learning objectives to the time we're going to spend together today. By the end of this session, students will be able to discuss the factors that make mobile entertainment the largest growth area in mass media today. Students will be able to explain the multi-platform workflow of transmedia, and students will understand the ways that the rapid rate of change in society is altering the business models in the entertainment and media industries. Now, I'd like to remind you that since this course is coming to an end, you have something else to look forward to. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable channel and webcast on the internet every week. This summer, we'll be broadcasting four more classes. Interdisciplinary Studies 336, Perspectives in Civilization. That's Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. Psychology 372, Industrial and Organizational Psychology. That's Saturdays from noon to 1:40. Social Behavioral Sciences 318, Cultural Pluralisms, Immigration. That's on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30. Finally, Humanities 310, Theater of Revolt, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years. And when we're done, we'll start all over again. So please visit www.appliedstudies.tv or call 1-866-278-6789. Now, we're going to start by looking at where mobile communications are right now. Remember the days of Dick Tracy's wrist radio? Well, it's grown up. It used to be a comic book joke, and it used to be his wrist radio because they couldn't even conceive of having a wrist phone. But it was basically a two-way communication system, and aka a phone. Now, that's how a lot of technological developments began, comic books and science fiction. Mobile phones are a major step in the development of mass media because they're always with us and they're convenient to carry. So when you have situations like this where we're all transferring everything we do onto the mobile phones, our banking, our workflow, everything else, you have privacy issues. And these considerations involve identity theft, data hacking, eavesdropping, and tracking by GPS, which ironically has been turned into a game called Foursquare. Think about that. Someone can track your every move. Now, the picture of teenage girls taking a picture of themselves is a cultural phenomenon because not only have we become an image-sharing culture, cameras are on every single cell phone now, but life is going by so fast for these teens that they're trying to record as many moments as possible. And this is an unfortunate development in their psychology because one of the things teens should be doing is pausing to reflect. Digital images have become their frame of reference, and they're shared via MMS with real friends and posted on social media with Facebook friends. Mobile phones help us share images of important events. Basically, in the future, historical record will come from digitally recorded video that came from cell phones. It'll be like the way we look at daguerreotypes today. The content will be created by both citizen journalists who have noble intent and sincere motives, and also citizens who look to capitalize and make some money on witnessing crime and tragedy. Whether or not you think you want it, major motion picture and television are moving to the mobile phone. Television series are already downloadable on your smartphone. So I have two predictions. One is that within 10 years from now, we're going to be docking these little devices onto our great big jumbo screens at home and watching the programming through the phone. The second, that programming is not going to be in 3D. I've said it before, I'll say it again, I think 3D is a fad, not a trend. Now, with teens and smartphones, they're the foundation of our future adults. So this is the generation that's going to drive this transformation. Kids are given cell phones at an increasingly early age. The GPS gives parents a false sense of security. While their phone's in the backpack, we can always figure out where they are. That assumes the backpack is always on the back of the child, which mothers know isn't going to happen. All the other kids have one. That's another reality, and you have to deal with it. If all the other kids have the cell phone, you want yours too. And look at this. We've reached a situation where we have full saturation globally of mobile phones. Cultures that never have landlines now have gone directly to cell phones because they lack the infrastructure and they ultimately didn't need it. So ironically, many of the developing nations and Asian countries specifically are ahead of us when it comes to mobile content development. Now, mobile phones have just enabled a revolution. And it's a revolution of democracy, thankfully. It's happened in Egypt, it's happening in Libya, and the dictators never saw it coming. Think about that. They underestimated the power of mass media, and that was their undoing. So the question becomes, who's next in the game of revolution, revolutionary roulette? We have this patent diagram. This is very cool because right now people say, well, there's problems with the batteries. We need better batteries. This is a patent application diagram that shows how you can recharge your cell phone by going like this, which is the same thing we all used many years on those Rolex watches. If you look at the way the technology is developing, we're going to see a clip right now about the future of mobile screen technology, and that'll tell you a lot about where we're going. Let's take a look. So when we look at this, I mean, basically, the generation that's in high school right now is going to grow up to be 20-somethings that never have a desktop that they're tied to. Everything goes into the mobile. Everything will travel with them when they want it. It's there. It will dock to all the other things, and it'll be automatically Bluetoothed in your house. So what we're looking at is a transformation that's coming socially but through technology, but it's being totally powered by the ability to have that connection with you everywhere you go, to become totally mobile through mobile communications. Now, there's the Mobile World Congress, which was held recently, not in the Silicon Valley or New York City or Hollywood. It was held in Barcelona. And it featured the now former Google CEO, Eric Schmidt. And you have to ask, why Google? Because in the future of mobile, Google will control the search engines, and Google will control what we're watching. It already has YouTube. YouTube is the current state of television. And it's going to develop the next generation of technology and applications that make it all run smoothly. So let's take a look now at a Google what Eric Schmidt has to say about Google Translation Services and how that's going to come into play.
At Mobile World Congress in Barcelona this week, Google previewed a new technology that allows its Goggles application for Android phones to recognize and translate text using the phone's camera and internet connection.
For the first time, again, it's a preview, like the German voice search. I want to preview with you optical character recognition paired with real-time translation. So I have, you can see this here, German language menu. And I would assume that many of you here would not be able to know what to eat tonight. But if you have the new Goggles translation, what you can do, you zoom in, take a picture. I should show this to you. Place it there. So the speech.
It wasn't the only language translation demonstration that Google did. The company also showed voice recognition working with a new language.
So we introduced English about a year ago, and since then we have covered Mandarin and Japanese language. And tonight, for the first time, I'm going to show you a fourth language, German. Guess that. So again, same process, maybe something simple first. Bilder von Berlin. So I apologize, normally it's much snappier, but since we're all competing here for bandwidth, but here you see some nice iconic images from Berlin. But how about something a little bit more involved? Let's say you want to know about the hip nightclub in Berlin. Techno Club Berghain Panorama Bar in Berlin. You know that place? Okay, so recommended. So here's the map, and you can, it has even a Wikipedia page.
Google CEO Eric Schmidt said it's only a matter of time before real-time translation can happen over the phone.
I've got voice recognition. I've got Google Translation, so I can translate from 100 languages into 100 languages. So why can't I just talk on the phone to somebody who doesn't speak my language? We're not quite there, but it's coming. And it's coming because of the unique intersection of computing and communications and cloud and cloud-based data storage.
Reporting from Boston, I'm Nick Barber, IDG News.
So mobile isn't about just mobile phones anymore. It's about the applications that we use to live our life, to do our business, and to function in every day much more effectively, and frankly, at a breakneck speed. We have the iPad, which is Apple and Mac. We have the BlackBerry, and we have the Android, which is Google. And guess which one is the fastest growing? It's the Android. Now, we have a CNET report from CES, which is the Consumer Electronics Show, 2011. That was held in January in Las Vegas. We're going to take a look at how the pads, the iPads specifically, are adapting in the younger generation's need to always be connected to their games. Let's take a look.
To the 2011 Consumer Electronics Show. It's Wednesday, January 5th. I'm Natalie Morris, coming to you from Las Vegas this week. It's time to get loaded. We're expecting big announcements out of the big press conferences this week, including companies like Sony, Motorola, and Intel. We do know a few things already about NVIDIA. The company is working hard to encourage 3D. They launched a 3D web page where users can share and view 3D content like games and movies. The site is called 3DVisionLive.com. HP may not be announcing tablets at this show after all. The company invited press to an event in February where it looks like the anticipated Palm Pad will be announced. Asus is ready with tablets, though. The company announced a line of tablets and phones here at the show. The ePad Transformer and ePad Slider are Android tablets that will run the Honeycomb variety of Google's operating system. The eSlate will run Windows, and the ePad Mimo is an Android phone. Video service Vudu announced that it will start streaming 3D movies. 3D titles will start appearing on Vudu menus next week, and they will be available in standard and high def. Of course, you need a 3D TV to take advantage of this, and we don't know how much they will charge for the streams yet. And finally, if you want to do more gaming on your iPad but you're missing those physical controls, check out the iPad joystick. The Fling is a transparent joystick that suctions to your iPad and gives you better control over your gaming. It costs $25. That's your news for today, but of course we're going to have a lot more for you from the 2011 Consumer Electronics Show, so please stay tuned to CNET TV all week. I'm Natalie Morris for CNET.com. And you.
Okay, so you see, you don't have to carry controls anymore. You have a pad, you have a couple of little silicone things, and there you are with your joysticks. This is going to appeal very, very heavily to the young male demographic, and of course, it's going to enhance the ability to put advertising that wants to reach those men. Now, we're going to take a look at the kind of individual who drives innovation. This is Sir Richard Branson. Does this guy look happy or what? That's one of the keys. He's British. He's 61 years old, although he certainly doesn't act like anybody's stereotypic representation of a 61-year-old man. He's a serial entrepreneur. That's the only term that actually applies to him, but it's a gross understatement. Forbes magazine says that he is the 212th richest person in the world. Something to aspire to. He's still only 212, but he is worth an estimated 4 billion U.S. He's British, so it's a little more in the pound. But it's interesting to note this individual. He's got dyslexia. He was a poor student. He does have excellent communication skills, and he's able to establish effective communications with others very quickly and seemingly effortlessly. When you see this man, you instantly are drawn to him. He is just so full of joy and happiness to be in whatever room he's in. He is the owner and inventor of many things. He started with a small company, which has ultimately grown to Virgin Airlines, Virgin Records, Music and Video, the megastores. He's also going into space, which I find fascinating. If NASA's not going to do it, it's going to take individuals, and he's going to be one of them. Now, Branson's first successful business, ironically, was a magazine. He was 16 years old when he started to publish Student Magazine. Now, Virgin Mobile has come up again, mobile, because this is for the iPad. Virgin Mobile has come up with The Project. It is a digital magazine designed specifically for the iPad. It cost a fortune to develop, but fortunately, Branson has a fortune. So we're going to take a look just at a brief clip of the super, super quick cover. And by the way, we're live. It's not previously recorded. We're going to take a look at the super, super quick clip of what the cover of the project looked like last month. Now, when you see an entire magazine that's interactive, and I do encourage you to go on the internet, if you don't have an iPad, go to YouTube and look at the demonstration of the project. And you can see that you're constantly doing this, up and down and flipping and popping and all of these other things, and it's quite fun to read. I don't know if this is going to translate into the new generation or if it's just a novelty. It's certainly a fun novelty, which everything Branson does is fun. So now we're going to move on to transmedia. Transmedia is a 360-degree experience. Transmedia starts with a simple concept, it's easy to access, and it's multidimensional. Now, when you look at the way that things are presented in real life, I bought a pack of gum. It's Eclipse gum. I prefer the polar ice flavor, for whatever that's worth. But there's a little thing on here that says, unlock secret footage with this pack. So you buy a pack of gum and you get access to the secret footage of Twilight Eclipse. Now, when you open the pack and take out your gum, you get to bring secret footage to life with this pack. Go to a website and type in this code. Then hold up your mobile phone and it will give you an image on it. If you don't have a super smartphone yet, you can follow other instructions to get to it. Now, this is obviously going to draw gum sales to the tween girls set who love, or the teen girls who love Twilight. But the bottom line is, advertising understands completely new transmedia content is the key. The best way to understand transmedia is to see how it works. So we're going to take a look at a really good example of it right now. Let's take a look.
Transmedia storytelling is the art of conveying messages, themes, or storylines to a mass audience through the artful and well-planned use of multiple media platforms. Your movie, television show, video game, or novel has a rich story and immersive world, but how do you maximize its value? You have a new product or brand, but how can you engage consumers in a way that intrigues, educates, and builds fantastic loyalty? It all starts with story. But in today's interconnected world, the story has the potential to start in one medium and flow into another. Bulletins about the approach of a mysterious sea creature are found throughout the internet months before the release of Cloverfield. A new generation of Star Wars fans, hungry for clues about their favorite Clone Wars cartoon characters, thrilled to the discovery of their fates while watching the original trilogy. Girls who adore the Tinkerbell DVD can then follow their favorite characters after journeying into the wider world of the Disney Fairies novels. Most of us flow naturally from one medium to the next. Unfortunately, most of our content doesn't. Instead, the stories are repurposed and repeated. They do not expand the franchise, nor do they build brand equity. With transmedia, each part of the story is unique and plays to the strengths of the medium. The result is a new kind of narrative where story flows across each platform, forming a rich narrative tapestry that manifests in an array of products and multiple revenue streams. The audience is both validated and celebrated for participating in the story world through the medium of their choice.
Now that's a sales promotional take to explain to potential customers why they want to use transmedia in their advertising or marketing campaigns. But it really pretty much says it all. Transmedia is psychologically sticky. It just is. You can't just push the button and make things sticky. You have to design them. They have to be totally crafted around a specific goal, which is spreading the word of a story, a brand story, and a story that, standing alone, has a value to the consumer to watch it. Now, transmedia combines two important qualities: effective storytelling and an immersive world, something that we can get involved in. Quote, the audience participates in the story world through the medium of its choice. We're going to see that in this tape that we're going to watch next. So let's take a look at this clip.
The Dark Knight, an alternate reality game, attracted more than 10 million unique players to real-time Gotham City, a city where the Joker left his mark on posters and bills and started building an army of henchmen all over the world. At Comic-Con, players gather to take their first orders from the Joker. Working with players online, they scavenged for clues and found a big one typed out in the sky.
Saw a bunch of jets writing a phone number. So we dialed that phone number and there was this little message.
If you want to be part of my crew, you're going to need to prove you're up to the challenge.
Players hit the streets dressed as their leader, and Gotham City began to spill out into the real world, building excitement and anticipation for the Dark Knight. Their efforts put together yet another piece of the puzzle.
And tonight you're gonna break your own rule.
A request to hit local landmarks in full Joker makeup. From London to the Middle East, to Pennsylvania, to India. A worldwide community formed. A chosen community. And a newspaper led them further into the world. A world where nothing was safe from the Joker.
Check out document note C651.
Where corrupt cops shame the city.
Internal affairs stands on the table. Sign off and walk downtown.
And where players picked up cakes at bakeries across America with a hidden package inside. A Joker phone to keep in constant contact with the world of Gotham City. A world they could choose to join in any way they wanted. Like a campaign to take back Gotham City.
Hello, I'm Harvey Dent, Assistant District Attorney of Gotham City. I'm calling to ask for your support.
Harvey Dent contacted players by phone and email and asked them to show their support. The response was overwhelming. Pictures streamed in, Dentmobiles brought Harvey Dent's message of change to 33 cities throughout the country. Citizens took to the streets, marched, protested, rallied, screamed, and chanted.
The pillify is just a way of saying, you know what, we're not going to take any more, but we're not going to do anything illegal and criminal.
You're wearing a button for Harvey Dent.
There it is. See it? I believe in Harvey Dent.
Truly, there it is.
The immersive marketing campaign was reaching a critical mass. Gotham City even reached into bowling alleys around the world.
ClownTravelAgency.com has a list of cities around the world. And on Tuesday, these addresses started showing up.
At first, I thought it was an April Fool's joke.
We knew that it was going to be a locker number and a combination locker.
Pulled the bag out, and everyone around me was like, open it, open it, open it.
My first reaction was just like, there's all these people around, grab the bag, get out, just go.
And when a trail of clues led players to an exclusive trailer of The Dark Knight, the Joker got there first. And the news burst out onto the web. It was big. But not as big as what happened the week of the Dark Knight premiere.
On Tuesday, hundreds of Gotham City residents, calling themselves Citizens for Batman, gathered in downtown New York City. And then at 10 p.m. sharp, they saw it, the bat signal. They didn't know what was coming. All they knew was that online clues sent them to the site.
But the Joker had plans of his own. In front of everyone's eyes, the beloved bat signal was defaced, along with everything else in Gotham City. From websites to videos to submissions, the Joker left his mark.
So you see, in order to effectively market a movie like Batman The Dark Knight, you have to have the support of the fanboys and girls, but they're all called fanboys. So what they did was they divide up. Do you support Harvey Dent, the good guy, or the Joker, the bad guy? They had cool graphics, which is essential. They had gaming story elements, which is, again, the key to making this work. And they had documents and evidence and actual objects that, if found, became very, very cool collectibles. When you have your fans marching in the street, almost like a flash mob, putting together a protest around your movie characters, you're setting yourself up for great success. But this isn't something that anybody can just go in and design. It takes a lot of craft. It takes a lot of skill. And the people who do it well do it brilliantly. Now, heroes on television use transmedia as well. And we're going to take a look at how that worked, because it was massively effective for a show that didn't have such great ratings but kept massive fanboy devotion. Let's take a look.
In the explosive Hero Season 1 finale, Hero Nakamura came face to face with his very own hero, Takezo Kenze, introducing viewers to Season 2, Generations. In the off-season and beyond, the Hero Saga continues online. Exclusive online content picks up the story where the show leaves off. In keeping with Season 2 Generations theme, original Hero's graphic novels explore the legacy of on-air characters like the Haitian, Mohinder, L, Claire, Matt Parkman, and the Petrelli brothers. Implementing cutting-edge technology, the weekly graphic novels were presented as animated multimedia experiences to be viewed online and on cell phones. Over the summer, the cast and creators of Heroes traveled the globe in anticipation of the series' international premiere. NBC.com covered the Heroes World Tour with photos, videos, and blogs from live events.
Enough fun for one day?
Expanding upon the success of the Emmy-nominated Heroes 360, NBC.com launched Heroes Evolutions, the immersive digital portal for Heroes fans. Users register to become part of the burgeoning Heroes online community and receive emails, phone calls, and text updates from on-air characters. YamagatoFellowship.org launched in an effort to preserve the legacy of history's greatest heroes. In a five-part original online documentary, fans experience the Takezo Kenze myths, retold in a unique 3D style, along with expert commentary.
Kenze was destined to draw the sacred sword to unify his country.
These web-only documentaries pave the way for Kenze's on-air debut in season two. Shortly before the series premiere, online fans witnessed the return of Hannah Gittleman, a character who was first introduced online, then leapt to the TV screen in season one.
She's a shiny new toy.
Hannah hacked into the final installment of Sword Saint, challenging fans to investigate several mysterious deaths in South America, while teasing the upcoming on-air storyline of Maya and Alejandro. In the wake of the Corinthian casino's demolition, Hannah bumped into on-air character Micah, sifting through the casino's digital rubble. Together, they invited users to jump in and become part of their discoveries. Hannah reached out to fans for help in exploring her past generations. Every week, Hannah supplied clues in a wide range of formats in an online scavenger hunt to find her missing uncle, the mysterious Drucker. Once exposed by fans, Drucker rallied Hannah's legions to help take down the company.
Together, we can destroy their infrastructure once and for all.
Meanwhile, Mohinder Suresh kicked off a dream study on his popular Activating Evolution website. Fans were invited to post their own dreams, some of which became original Heroes graphic novels. In addition to Heroes Evolutions, thousands of pages of content can be found at NBC.com's Heroes website. Fans can watch full episodes with simultaneous commentary from the show's cast and creators, and chat with them during live blogs.
That was a good hit. It was a great hit.
The two-screen experience also allows users to interact with the show during broadcast and test their knowledge against the online community with polls and trivia. Fans are invited to submit their own artwork to the online art gallery and create their own video mashups. The online audience pitched in to create and choose their very own hero, slated to appear in original online webisodes. Heroes, widgets, and embedded news updates are now available for users to personalize their own websites, blogs, and online profiles. With original online stories that impact and extend on-air broadcasts, unique web and mobile features, and countless ways for fans to interact, Heroes on NBC.com offers the most innovative and immersive interactive TV experience on the web.
Now, that show ultimately was canceled, but, you know, you have to admit, if you watched it, especially in the early years, these characters were endearing, and it was a different twist on what we'd seen before. So, transmedia is actually a marketing device that enables people to have more interaction with a brand or characters that they enjoy, that they embrace emotionally, and it's a win-win scenario for both, if it's done effectively. If it's done poorly, it falls flat on its face, it costs a fortune for nothing. So, now we are going to get to the portion of today's program, which is indeed pre-recorded. We are going to, I've saved the best for last, I think. We're going to meet Peter Deckham. Peter Deckham is an entertainment attorney who has basically represented every studio head in this industry. He has represented captains of industry outside of Hollywood, and he is just a remarkably brilliant man. His billable hour starts at $850, but you're going to get to spend that same time with him today for free. Aren't you lucky? Listen carefully. If you're taking this class, and even if you're not, you're going to want to come back to the website and watch this later. He has so much to say about where the entertainment industry is now, where media is, and where it's all going. So take a look at Peter Deckham, entertainment attorney, pre-recorded interview.
You frequently talk about Ray Kurzweil and his theory of accelerated rate of technological change. How does that apply to the entertainment industry?
Well, it's actually more than just technological change. He's actually talking about the mass of data and information in a society measured by its tangible output. What it does a lot of things. First of all, it creates obsolescence at warp speed. You know, it's how you use the Star Trek illusion, which somehow has been integrated into our language. It also has resulted in a complete brain rewiring of the youngest members of our society. The younger you are, the more likely you are profoundly rewired in the way you analyze and think.
So, things have changed a lot over the last 5 years.
Well, I can give you some numbers. 200 years ago, the sum total of accessible data in the world about changed every 200 years. If you were to take, according to Ray Kurzweil, if you were to take the year 2000 as a single year unit of change, by the end of the century, humanity will have experienced 20,000 year units of change if you apply the same mathematical rate of accelerating change. What this does for somebody who's, it makes everything faster. You'll notice kids are doing things back and forth more rapidly. But it also changes thematic content. It changes the value proposition for movie stars. It changes a lot of things. Because if you're now so used to rapid change, you can't live in the here and now. You're looking for the what's next. So I don't call them millennials or the Z generation, which is sub-millennial. I call them the what's next generation. Because they're rapidly looking for what's next, what's cool. If it is, it can't be cool.
So what has multitasking done to us with all this change?
Well, first of all, I want to understand what is multitasking. The first thing is people think that it is focusing on a bunch of things at the same time. No, not true. The human brain is capable of doing one focused analytical task at a time. You can't actually deep think two or three things at the same time. What you can do is rapid focus shift. So I call that living in a world of accelerating distraction. And anybody who, sits there in an office and you see, bing, my email just had a phone rings, rarely. No one young is going to be on it. They will have texted you or communicated with you in some other way. I was shocked last night. My son telephoned me. you complain to young people, these iPhones, the cell phone isn't very good. And they say, yeah, but so what? Who uses the phone? Multitasking has some very deleterious impacts. One, while you're driving, I don't care if you're on Bluetooth, you are distracted if you're talking on a phone because your mind has to respond in some method involving maybe a modicum of thought to the person on the other end of the phone. In that moment when you're thinking about what to say or you're saying it, your mind is not analyzing the road 100%. That's just a fact. Doesn't matter if you've got holding the phone to your head or not. It ain't working right. Number two, people, younger people, and I mean by this we're looking at probably under 18, are involved in something called process learning as opposed to focus learning. Process learning is probably a colloquial way of saying this, is habit learning. You learn how to learn facts and you do it in spurts, but since you're constantly being distracted, you don't linger with the thought to figure out where the thought came from. In 2006, UCLA did an interesting study where they said, okay, what's the difference in learning capacity between young people who are living in a highly distracted multitask universe and what is the impact of people who are able to sit there and linger on a complex problem for a long period of time? They actually found different parts of the brain involved in the learning. People who multitask store that knowledge in a part of the brain that isn't as actively involved in complex problem solving. People who are willing to sit down and engage in focused learning, non-distracted learning, but really concentrating on one thing for a long period of time, generate greater problem solving ability and greater learning ability. Now, in my mind's eye, part of this should be communicated to kids to let them make their own choices. If you want to be a process learner, it's your choice. But if for some reason you believe in your life that you'd like to be involved in deep thinking, analytical thought, and creating complexity in a world that really, really pays you well only if you do think in complexity, maybe they should know there's a choice. Because to the extent that you don't engage in focused learning, that part of your brain, like an athlete who stops working out for a year, simply atrophies. And it doesn't work. And we're finding in a job market that the kids are not coming out with the necessary focused learning capacities to solve the intense problems in a very complicated society. We're doing that to ourselves. Meanwhile, we're lowering our educational standards and cutting educational budgets. That's all cool if you like ignorance, and many people do.
So with the whole focus now on how the younger ones communicate, when does the new middle age start?
Well, interesting. It leads to a second almost necessary question. What is a generation? If you asked a 27-year-old to describe the daily lifestyle and expectancies of someone who's 22 or 21, they're on different planets. They don't speak the same language. They don't have the same culture. And yet there's a five-year age difference. If you talk to somebody who is 60 years old and you deal with someone who's 50 years old, they're both boomers, and there's enough commonality in the way that they communicate with each other. But if you add in the component of hyper-accelerating change, the necessary corollary to that is in a real generation, meaning people who have common social attitudes and common experiences, literally is now down to 3 years, 3 to 5 years. Now, if you're marketing, this is a real pain in the butt, because now, instead of having big generational demographics or psychographics to deal with, you're now dealing with all these subsections that are literally little generations within themselves, and the complexity of reaching them all becomes very, very hard. Even if you have a common psychographic attitudinal approach, you can't technologically deliver to them in the same way. Like, if you talk to a marketing executive at a studio today, and you say, do you like setting, you know, creating viral email campaigns to reach teenage audiences? Most of them will nod in agreement. And then you pull out the statistics. Number one, kids who are teenagers don't use email. You know, they may send their lesson plan to a professor or a teacher, or they may respond to an elderly parent or a decrepit grandparent. But that's not how they communicate. 11% of that target demographic routinely uses emails. In 2010, the reduction of teenagers using email was 59%. They'll text you, they'll get on a social network, but they don't waste their time with the email thing. So as you're watching these marketing executives building these extraordinary viral marketing campaigns, but there's nobody to infect the virus and spread it.
You know, it's interesting because I have three sons. I'm constantly texting, which is not appropriate for my age group. So how much of that is carrying over through the millennials' parents?
If you want to talk to your kids, you learn how to text. Mm-hmm. If you don't want to talk to your kids, I mean, it's not like you're sitting at the table texting each other. And there is an occasional need for phone. You know, I really hate the concept of somebody driving a car and texting. My wife tells me I do it at stoplights. I should immediately stop doing that or she's getting out of the car, in which case, because I'm a good husband, yes, dear, right away, dear. But it is tempting. So, I mean, when you're communicating with somebody, you want to communicate in the manner they want you to communicate in, not necessarily the one that you want to communicate in. So I tend to know how to do communication in just about any format possible, including yelling, smoke signals, semaphores, and occasionally even, oh, no, I can't. I'm dating myself. I'll use a telephone.
Okay. Thanks to this generation, we've come up with what I like to call the idolization of mediocrity. Is this whole thing about the speed and the texting and not going for quality, is that hurting us?
I don't agree with that. I think that in a society that has a lot of people, I mean, I look at my son. If I were to define quality, I would use him as an example. Everything he's done in his life in terms of, he's 27 years old. Maybe he's too old to be considered young, but I'd like to think he's young. He's my son. You know, he's got a fine education. He's gone to great schools. He's got graduate education. I mean, he's quite an extraordinary human being, and you can have amazingly depthy conversations with him on a range of topics from, you know, global conflict to modernity. He's an investment officer in the United States Department of Energy, the youngest investment officer there. I think the idea of what quality is, first of all, quality by definition is qualitative. Qualitative, by definition, is subjective. So the minute you add a pejorative and an analytical set to quality, that means you've got a standard you're applying, and it's normally your own. If a kid were to apply the standard, they might say, well, what you're calling quality isn't quality to me. You know, if you're looking at what's historically quality, is Shakespeare quality? Well, he wrote an awful lot of great stories. And if you can get rid of the old English in it and read it for what the thematic material he presented, the characterization, he's a home run. But I've never met somebody who likes, you know, stories who you tell them a Shakespearean tale who doesn't like the Shakespearean tale. It's fascinating. characters are wonderful, and they hold up today. They just speak in this funny way.
But do you think your son is the exception or the rule?
You know, I have a jaded experience because when I visited him at Duke University where he was an undergraduate, I was surrounded by excellence. I see an awful lot of mega bright young men and women. I think mediocrity is what we're doing to our young people by denigrating the educational system, not spending as much money, having greater class size. And the harsh reality in that space is we're up against countries who are elevating the level of education. They're elevating math, science, and analytical skill sets, and we're cutting them. That's not what the kids are. That's what we're doing to our children. And I, you know, to say, look, kids, you're mediocre, they could turn around and say, yeah, what kind of an education did you give me? And touche. We really have no explanation for that. I think if you give bright young men and women an educational environment that's stimulating and not overcrowded, they're gonna flourish in any environment. And they had this graph in the magazine which basically showed by 2023 we will be able to create every single cell that a human brain has in thinking power, and by 2045 we'll be able to aggregate all of humanity in a single computer.
But then what?
Who needs Peter? But that's okay, he's dead.
By 2025?
No, by 2040.
2040, okay.
2025, I think I'm going to be around. But okay. You never know. There are enough angry people out there that could, you know, cut me short.
So let's talk about Hollywood. How relevant is Hollywood to the rest of the world?
What is Hollywood? First of all, is it a place? Is it an industry? Is it centralized, decentralized? Are we talking about major studios and networks? What are we talking about when we say Hollywood? I mean, so many movies, majority of movies that the Hollywood infrastructure distributes aren't made, you know, not filmed in Hollywood. Does that mean that Hollywood extends its reach? Are we talking about Los Angeles? What do you mean?
The Hollywood entertainment machine. Let's start there.
I think there's a lot of obsolescence in a machine that's 75 to 100 years old. Right behind this building is Warner Brothers, which is an amazingly creative institution. But just looking at it, I'm seeing acres and acres and acres of buildings. Every sound stage has a group of technicians that maintain the stage, whether it's used or not. I see buildings across the street with Warner Brothers Big WB on them. Everywhere I go, it's there. And I say, what are all these people doing? Especially in a world where you can outsource things and where things are more mobile and decentralized, what do they all do? And I then asked myself the question, if you were given Warner Brothers to reshape, what would you do? And I started thinking, well, I'd get rid of the stages, the real estate. And I said, where would you get rid of real estate in this real estate market? I said, oh, well, thank God I don't have to do that.
So you once said, and I'm quoting, Hollywood may be free-falling in a downward spiral toward oblivion. Do you still think that's true?
The old Hollywood model is absolutely free-falling into oblivion. And everybody who's in the business is trying to find ways to slow it down. I don't think anybody actually believes they can stop it anymore. And if they can slow it down, maybe they can shift it to the next generation to deal with. Someone said, legal DVDs in China is like democracy. Neither exists. I mean, the realities are that people are getting content when they want it, how they want it. And all these battles going on between exhibitors and distributors over windows, over when you can get stuff. There's a whole bevy of consumers out there that just don't care. They're getting the content on day one from whatever source they feel like getting it. Sometimes piracy is a marketing event. They want to see it on a big screen. Sometimes piracy is piracy.
And is there any upside to piracy?
I guess if you can embed advertising in pirated copies, you can, and measure quantitatively the number of people who've absconded with your model, there's a monetization in that. But I think piracy has always existed at one point in a little. You know, if you go, there's a book called, I think it's called Piracy, massive book. Mm. And you look at that and you see, where did copyrights come from? Because until you could duplicate things, until you had a printing press there was no need for copyright. Every piece, you know, it's so much work to copy. You had to copy. You had to get a scrivener in there, and they had to do a copy. But almost from the get-go, as guilds formed to try to protect literary rights, there was almost no protection. And it's fascinating to look at how, at one point, the monarch said, well, I'm the monarch. You created my kingdom. I own it because I am the monarch and you're not. So I will give you the right to publish a book, or I'll take it for myself. And so those are patents where the monarch would say, issued. And it just, you know, during the French Revolution, they repealed copyright. They thought it was completely and totally anti-democratic. Why should anyone have any restriction to books and writings? It's a freedom of... So if you look at piracy, it's not exactly new. It's just taking new and exciting forms. When I was in Cuba a couple of weeks ago, I looked up at the marquees at a number of local municipality-owned theaters, and I saw Black Swan, The King's Speech. I saw a whole bunch of movies, all currently playing in the United States. And I know for an absolute fact that American studios are prevented legally from making any distribution deals with Cuba, to which Cuba says, okay, we'll just do it our way. But they're on the theaters of government-owned theaters. And they're signatories to the Berne Copyright Convention, which means even if the United States and Cuba are at odds, they're supposed to be honoring copyrights.
In that case, isn't there an ancillary benefit, though? Because we get to promote the spread of democracy through them seeing what our life is like.
Yeah, Black Swan's going to make everybody want to move to the United States. I think they all want to move anyway. I mean, one of the strange things about Cuba is they love Americans and they figure it's just a matter of time before they're normalized. But it's not a consumer economy. Going cost of a movie, 10 cents.
Wow. So things have changed with the box office intake. It used to be 21% came from theatrical and 60% came from DVD. Is that still holding up?
Hell no.
So what's happened?
I want to see the skew coming out. First of all, DVDs are declining. We've had it over the last 3 years. We've seen a 20-30% decline in unit sales of DVDs in the United States. And they're being substituted with, you know, digital replacements, Blu-ray to a certain extent. Mm-hmm. But the net economic value of the aftermarkets is definitely contracting on a hard dollar basis. But there's some interesting new changes. HBO, Showtime, et cetera, were cutting their pay television deals in half from what they were 5 or 6 years ago. And then all of a sudden Netflix pops in and says, you know what, I want to buy some of these rights for my platform. And I can probably pay a little bit more because I got 20 million subscribers. And I'm going to bid this up. And Showtime and HBO said, well, we have HBO Plus. We have HBO Plus isn't an incremental value to HBO. They don't make more money from that. But they also started realizing that if Netflix got it first, it diluted their HBO and Showtime values. So they're beginning to inch back up in what they pay. I'm actually seeing the world sort of split less in terms of windows, although right now the battle between the theater owners and the studios is going to come to blows. It's very, very nasty. I mean, nobody on this planet believes that 60 days out from initial theatrical release, Warner Brothers is going to sell a lot of people on a $25 ticket. I don't think Warner Brothers thinks it either. I think that's a placeholder. When that fails, and I think they expect it to fail, they're going to drop the price and move the windows forward, and the theater owners are going to have a big conniption fit, and they are having one right now over that particular arena. At some point, it may be that the only way that it's going to work is for the people putting stuff on cable to do a revenue share with the theater owners to try to equalize, you know, where the losses are going to be. We are overscreened in this country. We have about 39,000 screens. In my estimates, and I've looked at it, I don't think this country really needs more than 25,000 screens. So that excess capacity is really causing problems. You've seen the recent joint venture between AMC and Regal, where they're going to actually, they got a guy named Tom Ortenberg who's going to go out and acquire a product in the independent marketplace to fill screen time. The barriers to independents getting to access theater screens is non-existent. Anybody can get a theater screen. The barrier to getting out there is marketing costs, and they will kill you.
Why does it cost so much to market a movie?
Well, I think I alluded to this already, and that is when you have sub-generations, each one receiving content in a different way, you have to reach them age-appropriate, even if you're sending the same message, through whatever medium you're going through. And we have yet to find a replacement for that pervasive value of network television, what it was 10 years ago. If you bought time on a popular network show, you knew you were reaching an awful lot of people. Today, that isn't necessarily the case. You can have a popular network show that reaches 5, 10 million, 11 million homes. Out of over 100 million homes, that's not as it's not significant. If you had those numbers back in the 1970s or 80s, your show would have gotten canceled.
Well, what about online marketing? Everyone's touting this as the cost-effective way to go.
Okay, tell me. It's people are saying, okay, cost-effective, I'm going to use the telephone. What does online marketing mean?
Through Facebook, through social media, through the long tail.
So I now have to access, I have to buy ad time, or I have to figure out something controversial. This audience is, it depends on which one you're going for. If you're going for older people, over 40, traditional media, no problem, they'll do it. If you're going for younger people, it's a lot easier, than you think. You go for teenagers, you're screwed. Teenagers and young adults. Because they're marketing resistant, males don't even watch television. Maybe they do fake news and sports. Probably the best bang for your buck in marketing is sports. Because time delays don't work. The minute you put a time delay in sports, I know how it came out. So people are likely to sit through the commercials for a sporting event just because it's now and it's only valuable now. That's why Academy Awards have value. That's why the Super Bowl has value. It doesn't have much value. Well, I think I'll tape the Super Bowl. I'll watch it next week. Yeah. It doesn't work that way. So how do you reach each demographic? How do you know you're reaching them? Oh, no, I have behavioral tracking software. Who's paying for that? Okay? So you're paying, and you're getting a lot of overlap. You're buying media very deep over a number of people simply because you reach some people in this media, you reach some people in that medium, and this overlap becomes very inefficient. You're overbuying the center of it just to reach the periphery of it, but if you don't reach the periphery of it, you don't get there. There's only one real marketing of motion pictures on planet Earth. It's word of mouth. May not involve words spoken. It may not actually involve a mouth. But at some point, people tend to go to movies their peer leaders tell them are good movies for them to go to. Who is your peer leader? It's a moving target. At any given moment, someone steps up and assumes the role of a peer leader in a what's next analytical set. Oh, I saw this movie. It's amazing. You got to see it. If there's no peer leader, how do you know you want to see it? Well, I saw a billboard. That just knows you're familiar with it. If you see marketing in movie theaters on trailers, very good. Because number one, if you're going in a movie that is attracting the kind of people you'd like to see your movie, you get a chance to see people who are already predisposed to see movies. They're in a theater already. Mm-hmm. Theater owners know that. And you're saying, well, you want your trailer in my theater at a key time. You want to pay me something for that?
But that's been going on for years.
Yeah, but it's getting worse.
Really?
Because theater owners are basically saying, we know that our value proposition is a lot cheaper than the media spend you're doing elsewhere. So, if you're nice to us, maybe we'll do it. If we're profitable, maybe we'll do it. Or if you write us big checks, maybe we'll do it. But it's not so automatic anymore.
So 3D, is it a fad or a trend?
Yes. 3D.
Show your work.
3D, first of all, I am a passionate believer in 3D, but not the 3D you're thinking of. I am tired of two-dimensional characters. Where I want to see 3D is I want to see internal conflicts in my protagonist, antagonist. Look, if you want to show me a cartoon, great, but let it be Batman, The Dark Knight. Let me see some complexity and texture in the characters. And that is the fascinating conundrum for family entertainment. The best family films work on two levels. One for the kids to see the stuff going on the screen is cool. And the other one to the adults who are actually looking for some kind of passionate connective tissue to the characters and their problems. If I see the same damn superhero, except he's got slightly varied powers, This one can freeze things. That guy can fly around. This guy can read your mind. But they don't have any rich texture. I'm tired of it. It's burning out. You know, I don't need more same stuff anymore. I need something that requires thought and has character enrichment in it.
But isn't there an audience coming up every 5 years, then, of the kids who haven't seen the other six?
Yeah. But it depends on how broad you want your market. If you're targeting kids, that's a great target. But if their parents don't want to take them, that's a deterrent. So the name of the game is how do I, and by the way, women are defining the motion picture business today, not men. Those days, I think the recession tanked that one. When you're basically dealing with resources, men opted for sports, women opted for the movie business. And even in family entertainment, when someone has to take the kiddies to the movies, mommy goes, dad stays home and watches the games on television. It saves money in a recession. Family entertainment is probably the biggest segment of the motion picture business, television business, that is recession resistant. If we're going to spend money as parents, we will always prioritize our children.
So why is it so hard to get the studios to understand the value of a G-rated movie?
It isn't the G-rated movie. It's the non-R-rated movie. The box office in this country, 50% of the movies produced in volume of number of films are R-rated. 77% of the box office is non-R-rated movies. So PG, PG-13, and G are clearly, they clearly outperform. But having a PG isn't death. Having a PG-13 isn't death. Having R begins to be fairly restrictive. Now, there's times when an R, look, Batman The Dark Knight was an R-rated movie. Could it have been PG-13? I think so, fairly easily. But I believe that, you know, you're targeting, I call family entertainment 8 to 80. I don't call family entertainment stuff for kids. That's called children's entertainment. Family entertainment is a different segment. Children's entertainment doesn't have high production value because it's a very narrow audience. It's tiny. But if family entertainment is gigantic, it's huge. It means I can go and bring my entire family to see, you know, Alice in Wonderland or Secretariat. Where I can get that 8 to 80. Targeting the youngest members of society is very, very difficult and is really, really requires budget control.
So what do you think of the new trend where animation, everybody wants PG animation instead of G?
Adults tend to want a little more complexity in the characters. The complexity in the characters may not be appropriate for the youngest segments of our society. Adults, there's several realities in animation. Number one, the people who are young adults today grew up with animation on television in prime time, whether it's The Simpsons, Beavis and Butthead, or whatever it may have been, South Park, etc. There came a moment where animation was called animation and not cartoons. Big difference. When they were cartoons, they were for children. When it became animation, it became an art form. And if you go to Japan, you can get downright R or NC-17 rated with anime. I mean, there's stuff there that goes over the top. That said, animation is just another art form, and to do it well is exceptionally difficult.
I want to go back to what you were talking about with Regal and AMC joining forces to pick up independent films. Why did the studios give up independent films for the most part?
Margins. They didn't make money on them. Cost too much, distracted management too much, took too much capacity, and didn't deliver the kind of money. I'll give you, for an average studio, they need to make a profit level above the cost of production, above the cost of marketing and distribution, somewhere around $30 million a movie. They can't make a $15 million profit because they have to amortize their corporate and studio overhead somewhere. So if they've got $20, $30, $40 million in that range of average corporate overhead, and the movie goes out, costs 10 to make, costs 50, you know, 20 to market, and it made 50, it didn't break even.
But what about ancillaries? Don't those movies do well in foreign?
That includes everything.
Okay. So what about actors? Do actors and stars guarantee a movie opening?
Am I going to get killed here? Let's talk about actors versus stars. Actors who are character actors and have a reputation of creating cool new characters are given an opportunity to demonstrate the coolness and the newness of what they've created. Johnny Depp is a star. He does, you know, Pirates. He does Alice. He's amazing. But then how do you explain The Tourist? How do you explain Sweeney Todd? The audience reacted positively to one creative character that he's done and not to another. But now when you look at leading men and leading women who play the same role, you know, a love interest, a powerful, I can do anything, those actors tend not to do well in more than two or three movies. They can do well in the sequels because people want to see the continuing storyline, and it's necessary to have the same character, not always Daniel Craig, James Bond, and all the other Bond people who were there before. But for the most part, people want to see continuity of characters. When they're in different movies and they're playing sort of the same player, life expectancy of movie stars is 2 to 3 years and gone, out, over. Why? They're not what's next. You're marketing a movie based on what is. It's uncool by definition.
Wow. I'd like to move over to television, kind of television. Why did Comcast purchase NBC Universal?
Because their cable channels and their cable subscribers were becoming commoditized. Commoditized bandwidth, i.e., I reach these people, I have no unique proposition. If they don't like me, they can pick it off satellite, they can pick it off another system, they can pick it off the internet. In the third quarter of 2010, we had something happen that had never happened before. We began to see massive disconnects off of cable subscribers. People were, I think there were 741,000 disconnects in the third quarter of 2010 of cable subscribers. People were saying, you know what, except for sports and news, anything that's available on television, I can get on the web. So all of a sudden, cable said, wait a minute, I really am being commoditized. What creates uniqueness for me? What is it? Oh, if I can have unique branded content that I put on my platforms that's protected at least vis-a-vis other comparable platforms by copyright law, then I have uniqueness. So I monetized my uniqueness and I decommoditized my bandwidth.
So you were talking about the youngsters, especially the males, watch fake news and sports. Then why is broadcast television desperate to program for this audience that's not going to come back to them?
Well, it isn't going to come back to them. Television is an 18 to 49 female demographic for the most part. You have exceptions. History Channel, men over college-educated males over 50. There are niches. Everybody looks at who spends money and is willing to change brands. Older people tend to be locked into the brands they choose. You know, I buy the same toothpaste. I've bought the same toothpaste for years. But you know what? I'm also a first mover when it comes to new cool electronic products and cars, so I think they're all idiots, but we already know they're idiots. The view is that we already have the females. We now have to get the males, and they're consumers that I can attract into new products if I can only get them to watch. And that's what they're trying to do. It ain't going to happen.
But when I look at that concept, I mean, I'll change brands in a heartbeat if I find something I like better.
That's not the assumption that advertisers make, and they're often very wrong.
Okay, they are wrong. Okay, because if you're talking about that group of women, 18 to 49, they're not being spoken to in programming very much anymore.
Well, they think they are. I mean, you're looking at people catering. Although I ask myself, what does an 18-year-old and a 49-year-old have in common, other than they're probably on opposite sides of menopause and having their first periods? I don't know what the commonality is. I don't see the commonality. I don't think you reach out and get all that group in one single swoop. It just doesn't happen. I think people are more intelligent than that, although I am often surprised that they're not. But you know, I think it's more complicated. There's a lot of niche programming. But remember, the smaller your niche, the less money you've got to reach them.
Okay, so how much of broadcast television is moving online?
All of it.
How fast?
It's here now. All of it. Every nanosecond, whether it's legal or illegal, whether it's on Hulu or not. Every second is available.
Then what happens with the broadcast networks after it's all on the internet?
Well, there's an interesting form of analysis when you're valuing a company. All the price earnings multiples, all the stuff you hear, multipliers, are all attempting to approximate something called an abnormal discounted cash flow. That sounds really complicated. All it means is money costs so much. we're going to value your company about on what you generate over the cost of capital until your value proposition merges into the cost of capital. So you have this sort of arc that comes down and ends at some point. What a good investment banker will do is net present value that entire arc of excess money over the cost of capital to present value, and that determines the value of a company.
So how valuable are the broadcast networks in this new media scape?
Visual aid coming up. Where is that? Where is that? Oh, here we go. Let's put it this way. Whoops. Who says I give no quarter? I have it on me. Okay, and you notice I made sure I had no money on me of any kind. Mm-hmm. I don't think networks have value. I think they're over.
How are they going to, do they know this?
I think they do.
And how are they handling it?
They're trying to buy into, get your eyes off that. they're trying to buy into new media, new platforms of distribution. They're trying to reinvent their advertising value. They're trying to have multiple platforms, so you get it here, you get it there, you get it somewhere else. They're also doing something that they didn't do until the last couple of years, and that is they're trying to get from cable systems a subscriber fee. It used to be that they just got carried, and they had their advertiser revenues. Cable channels would have 50% of the revenue base coming from advertising and 50% from subscriber fees, not counting the premium channels, but the average basic cable channels. The networks are saying, wait a minute, why are we being discriminated against in a digital universe? And you saw the battles with ABC and the various cable casters, and that's what where they're trying to find survivability. In the long term, the traditional old world broadcast model is dead, gone, buried. Those companies, if they are on that model and don't have additional revenue streams, are toast. They're not worth anything. They're worth zero.
So let's switch over to the real online. AOL buys Huffington Post.
AOL? What's AOL yet? Oh, I have a my old world email address is, okay, I have a corporate one that I use much more. AOL? I understand what they're trying to do. They're trying to be a content aggregator in the news space. They're trying to become a news medium. Look at the New York Times. They just announced that they're going to be selling people to write. If you read more than 15 or 20 stories mm-hmm. a month, you're going to pay $15 a month. If you read more stories and you want it on more, you know, platforms, you want it on your iPad, you want it on your cell phone, you pay more. I don't think that's going to be particularly successful. I know that Rupert Murdoch and the Wall Street Journal had an easier time of it because subscriptions to business magazines can be passed on to the employer.
Interesting.
So there's a little less resistance. Mm-hmm. Oh, I can be legal and my boss will pay for it. Okay, I get that. Right now, the last 5 years, newspapers have lost half their subscribers and half their ad revenues. And if you start looking at that model and realizing USA Today lost, in the last couple of years, 20% of its subscriber base, it's just paper is vaporizing and tablets are helping accelerate the vaporization of newspapers. And again, I don't know what a tablet is other than a computer without a keyboard. And that's where it's going. You can figure everything is going to be a computer. No matter how tiny it is, it's going to be a computer.
But if you look at
Richard Branson.
Richard Branson did a thing called The Project. And that was interesting because it actually had interactive ads. It had content moving all over the place. It was a little fun. I'm wondering, after the novelty wears off, how long is that going to stick around?
Well, people have to want the content. One of the most important things in marketing today is it's hard, especially the younger generations, to push content to consumers. You have to give them a reason for them to pull the marketing message to them. So you have to create increasing relevance. I love car ads. You know, you want to have me watch stuff, show me cool car ads. You know, if there's some commercials that I find entertaining and amusing, and I'll just watch them. But for the most part, you know, especially if you have TiVo things, there go the commercials. So people are embedding the commercials in the programming. They're wrapping around the programming. They're doing it so if you fast forward through stuff, there's still a subliminal message that shows up on your screen. But in the end, people shop. People want things. And they find out things that they want. They'll ask their friends. By the way, there's a joint venture between Facebook and Bing, so that when you ask a shopping question of Bing, if you're on Facebook, it can also poll your friends as to what they're doing in the same space. Interesting issues. So as you start looking at marketing, it stops being, what should my message be that I'm sending out? The new marketing mantra is, what questions do I ask of which people? That is marketing today. It's not like I send my ad campaign and say, this is it. I create an ad campaign and ask people, what do you think about it? How should I change it? Who do I ask that of? How do I get them to interact with me? I mean, if you look at Google, they have automatic, you know, when they have web pages, if you subscribe to the right service, it'll automatically just, what happens is they'll do different versions of the ad, and as they get more hits on one particular version, that ad starts to, predominate over the other ones. There's lots of behavioral tracking that goes on, and all that stuff is creating metrics to make the ads more compelling and make people want them.
So you have a situation where MySpace was the big thing.
MySpace, what's that?
Well, it was the big thing until it was bought and monetized. Now Facebook is starting to do it. Is Facebook going to go the same way as MySpace?
Every single platform on planet Earth is in an entropic mode. Everything is ending as it begins. I look at Microsoft, and they really and truly believe that because they control the Windows operating system, they have no fear of the future. I look at it and saying, that's the easiest company to blow away on the planet. They have no future. Their Xbox, you know, it's not pushing it the way they should. Look at the Wii, it's already gone. MSN, you know, I don't know what Microsoft is. I don't know what they're doing. They've had the same basic product, you know, this Office suite, et cetera, for a long, long time. You know, people have been seen using Office equipment, Windows equipment, slumping forward out of boredom and going to sleep. It's not an exciting company. There are lots of fiefdoms. They've missed the mobile operating systems completely. They've been blown away by Android and the Apple platforms rather totally. That doesn't mean they can't come back, but what you're seeing at Microsoft right now, maybe what their name really means, small and soft, it's a completely boring, non-existent, old-world company that's already unraveling at warp speed. It's just coming apart.
What about Google? Where do they go next?
Google is interesting. They have a ways to go, but you'll notice that their annual growth rates have gone down from the 50-40% level. They're now down more 20%. Those are major growth rates in a recession economy, but they're coming down. And they are trying very hard to be entrepreneurial. They pick up a lot of young companies, and they tend to keep the entrepreneurs who are involved in those companies in the platforms to make them work. And the most interesting observation I had of Google presents itself to the world as a technology company, but it isn't anymore. It's a media company.
So they've got YouTube poised to become the next television.
It already is television. They have monetization plans so that even casual users, when they hit a certain number of hits, they start sharing in the ad revenues. And you have companies that have started up, like Demand Media, just went public for a nice billion-plus dollar number. They do their own ad sales, and they then place the products into Google and other search engines, and they share revenue backwards. So in other words, instead of Google selling the ads, Demand Media sells the ads and shares that revenue back with Google. That, to me, is, Google's looking to become a television network. You're going to see Google stepping into this, well, maybe I'm going to buy the space that Showtime buys now and Netflix. Maybe I'm going to come in there and give Netflix a run for their money. Because as Netflix moves away from hard disk mailers into streaming, kind of looks a lot like Google, huh?
Yeah, it does. So let's go back to print for a minute.
Someday my prints will come.
Is the newspaper subscription model dead?
Toast.
Okay, so assuming consumers accept a paywall to a certain extent, How can the New York Times compete with HuffPo, which doesn't pay any of its content providers?
Well, if there's one periodical I'm likely to pay for, it's going to be the New York Times. I think it's the best newspaper in the United States. That said, I think we're going to live more in a world of news aggregators, which is what AOL is trying to be. And a number of other services are trying to aggregate. You know, if you subscribe to me, you get 17 newspapers. And then they revenue share, rev share with the newspapers, but they take too big a slice and newspapers aren't happy. Okay, those models will start sorting themselves out. And again, a newspaper is like a television network and the articles within it are like programs. So as you start finding articles sort of detaching from the network, detaching from the newspaper, there is a value proposition that goes with them. I blog and I use, you know, New York Times, LA Times, Wall Street Journal, a lot of these players. And they're very useful to me. They inspire stories, AOL News, Daily Finance, all AOL platforms now, Huffington platforms. And they inspire stories. Of course, I go and do a lot more additional research. Let's hear it for Wikipedia, which is not always accurate. But, you know, there's stuff out there. The advertising model can only take you so far. If you can find a way to grow your subscriber base outside of the United States into other areas, there's a global market out there. And I think there's going to be some very interesting software that's coming up. It's going to do simultaneous translation in idiomatic form.
Wow.
So, I mean, if you actually think about the complexity, let's take a movie. It's done in English, and I want to translate it into German. So I know eventually, with the computer capacity that's growing as fast as it is, there's going to be a computer program that will, A, recognize the harmonics of the speaking actor, replicate that harmonic in a different language, and computer process to lip match in real time in order to do simultaneous translation. When that software penetrates the earth, the ability to access global markets, now the competitive stage is no longer English-speaking America, it's planet Earth.
So Esperanto is going to be a software, not a language.
I think that's correct.
So let's talk about mobile. Most of the content you see on mobile is repurposed from other medium. How come nobody's come up with a new way to do mobile entertainment?
Mobile entertainment is a new way. I mean, it just is. It depends on where you consume it. And what I find fascinating is older people will say, you know what, I look at my cell phone, I can't imagine watching a movie on this thing. 3 feet away will be a kid sitting on a subway car watching a movie on this thing. It, you know, the truth is, everybody consumes what they want the way they want it. I think it's less about mobile, less about tablets, computers, internet. It's more about, I want to see what I want to see, when I want to see it, where I want to see it. And if I happen to be using the access device as a mobile phone, great. A tablet is either a computer without a keyboard, but it's another explanation. It's a mobile phone without, you know, a microphone, although they have that too. Hello, hi. It's not a little awkward, but hey, it works. You can Skype your way into the new iPad, so there you go.
The music industry.
What? What was that? Did I say the word, to hear the word music and industry simultaneously uttered in the same breath?
The post-Napster music recording industry. What's going on there?
It's a pretty ugly writhing death for the industry model as we know it. It's morphed into a much more valuable live performance model, but the marketplace doesn't support a lot of live performances. You have to be pretty big to do that. You're seeing new groups being born doing advertising jingles, promoting their work. You're looking at people doing 360 deals, which means I'll take money any way you earn it, you stupid music act. Sign with my label, and if you become a real estate broker, I'm going to get a piece of your real estate business because I'm assuming it's because you're a musician that everybody wants you to sell their house. The models don't work, but as a corollary to that, the cost of recording music has dropped through the floor. You know, if you've got 10 grand around, you can buy yourself a very sophisticated mixing board, recording facility, good microphones, and you can do good stuff. The garage band now sounds like a studio-produced unit. So you have the ability to make music on a margin, and then it's kind of up to you how you monetize it.
how you monetize it, maybe performing in clubs and selling, you know, your CDs, or the new CDs and the new DVDs are DVD with clouds. And that we're going to very fast. If I buy a piece of content on any device, I'm buying the content, not the device. So you're seeing today, if someone buys a DVD, they get a permanent access card to that content in any platform they want in the clouds. That means on somebody else's file server that I can reach through my mobile carrier, I can reach in my, you know, by internet. And I think that makes a lot of sense.
So as we close.
The closure.
What are some of your pet peeves?
There's so many. My biggest pet peeve is thinking you can solve problems by giving them a slogan-like name. I see people outsourcing their opinion to people who have cute slogans that have absolutely no shot of solving the problem. The notion that in a complex society there are simple solutions is also a pet peeve. People think if I do this and I do it consistently, all my plans will come to fruition. Life doesn't work like that. For every action, it's not just an equal and opposite reaction. There are a whole bunch of side effects you didn't anticipate. I mean, for example, nuclear reactor in Japan causes problems. People are getting radioactive mail in New York. Huh? Who would have said, you know, folks in New York, you better watch your mail. If there's a nuclear reaction in Japan, it might be radioactive. Nobody thinks that way. You had three or four backup systems on this reactor in Japan, all built to, you know, first we have electricity that powers pumps that cool it down. If they don't work, don't worry, I got diesels coming up, pumping stuff in. That doesn't work, don't worry, I got batteries. Who knew an earthquake would take out the electrical system that manned the pump? Tsunami would take out the diesel power, and the batteries only had a four-hour useful life. We built San Onofre and Diablo Canyon to withstand a 7.0. Everyone knows the big one, 7.8 to 8.1. Who are you kidding? And people are always doing that, and that is, it won't happen here, or if I just adopt, we reduce the deficit, everything will be fine. If you reduce the deficit, how do you do that? I fire lots of government workers. Oh, there's an unemployment problem in the United States. So if I fire all those government workers, they're not buying things, they're not paying rent, they're not paying their mortgage, and they're available to take the jobs that are already out there for the other people that are looking for work. There are no simple answers. It's complicated.
Thank you so much for explaining it all to us.
Unshred.blogspot.com. I explained it to everybody there.
Thank you, Peter.
My pleasure.
So I hope you saw that as the great opportunity to get some understanding from one of the folks that advises the people at the top at all of these corporations. Now, as we start to wind down, I want to go back to something we talked about in the very, very first episode of this program. Why do I think funny pet videos explain the future of all mass media entertainment? Well, let's start with a clip. Tucker plays the piano. Funny pet videos explain the future of successful mass media because they're four quadrant stories. Kids can identify with them and adults find them endearing. They transcend the barriers of language and culture. A video made about a cat in China can appeal to people in all cultures and countries. They're based in real life situations. People record the things that animals do in real life, and whether or not the pet is trained to do them is totally irrelevant. They contain elements of suspense. Will the cat pounce or won't he? Does the porcupine know that he's under surveillance? And what happens to the cat if he does pounce? They tell stories about relationships, both friendship and romance. They tell buddy stories that show both cooperation and competition. They have action scenes. Please note, this becomes a comedic scene if someone actually tossed that in and told the dog to fetch. They involve stunts. They have genres. Here we're looking at the ever-popular war genre. Add Godzilla, you have science fiction. And of course, there's superheroes. Here we have slapstick comedy. Basically, it's the four-paw version of Laurel and Hardy. Sometimes they even have romantic bathtub scenes. They're not star-driven, even if this cat does look like Jack Nicholson. And they're cost-effective. This guy is the writer, producer, director, and editor. Basically, he's the ultimate auteur. They're suitable for product placement. They enable us to experience compassion. And they illuminate our differences. Please note, the dog is not Jewish. They tell stories that illuminate the human experience because we see ourselves reflected in our experience with animals. They're emotionally satisfying, and the most satisfying emotions result in a smile. But basically, they remind us that we're all in this together. And this is why funny pet videos are so popular. Any mass media content that contains all or many of these characteristics will be successful. And it's as simple as that. You know, Peter Deckham was talking about people have to want to see the content you provide. This past week at Cinecom, which is the conference where all of the theater owners come together with all of the studio people, the stars are trotted out in a kind of horse and pony show, and they talk about how they're going to do business next year. Basically, the theater owners have said, you know what the problem is? People would go to the movies, except the movies suck. Okay, they didn't use that word. They said the movies aren't good anymore. And that's kind of true. Think about the last few movies you've seen and ask yourself how they compare to the movies you saw maybe 5 years ago. Now, as we looked at all of the things mass media is involved in, what a force of power this is, whether it's starting a revolution in politics across the other side of the globe, or whether it has the potential to start a revolution in education right down the block from you. You're watching mediated instruction and distance learning. 20 years ago, if you wanted a college degree, you had to go to campus. You had to get into a college that was near you or that you could move to, and you would have to go there every single class period. Here, if you're a mom with young kids, if you're a disabled person who has limited mobility and access becomes a problem of physically getting to and from someplace, you can still fulfill your intellectual potential because of the power of mass media. Now, all of this has been used over the last century. We've seen the effect that mass media has on politics, on the simple little spin that one tiny clip of video footage. Let's talk about what happened when one candidate, who was actually on his way to the top, said, yee-haw, and the only feed that went out was the one that he was mic'd for. Not the shouting and hooting and hollering of all the other people around him, but just that one thing. And suddenly, a political campaign was at its end, and the career of an individual who was quite a good leader was over. Now, mass media has the power to do good, and it has the power to be problematic. We have mass media that has shown bits and snippets of how certain people are treated with the police, and it's been transferred over the internet through news media. It's been covered globally. We have the ability to see a story not only as it's told through our local news, but the national news, and then we can switch over to BBC on our cable television and see how they see it. We can go to Al Jazeera on the internet and see how they see the same story. We are able to look at all sorts of things in the world around us from different points of view. And that's a huge benefit to the way that we're growing intellectually and emotionally as a society. Now, I want to talk about briefly the key element of every bit of mass media that you're ever going to see. And we're going to reference a quote by Ursula K. Le Guin. There have been great societies that did not use the wheel, but there have been no societies that did not tell stories. We talked about Joan Didion, who says, we tell ourselves stories in order that we may live. I told you about my screenwriting teacher and mentor, Sam Rafelson, who said a story is about people and what happens to them. Story is at the key of everything we do. When I go and have breakfast tomorrow with my BFF, I will tell her the story of what I did this week, and she will tell me the story of what she did this week. We communicate in stories whether or not we're aware of it. And so if the story that that's coming across mass media does not ring true to the person receiving it, it's problematic. It's not going to be a successful transmission of mass media, and people will go to something else. Everything that's available, that has been talked about for the last 13 weeks, is available on the internet for future reference. You can go back and you can see the interview with Peter Deckham, which is chock full of information. You really want to watch it two times if you want to understand the full breadth of what he's saying. You can go back and listen to how Phil Rosenthal explained his involvement in the creation of one of the most successful sitcoms in the world. You can go back and hear all those things that I've talked to you about and rewatch the clips. And that's the joy of modern media. Because if you were taking this course in a classroom, you wouldn't necessarily be able to do that. We're going to do a quick read run of the learning objectives for today. By now, you should be able to discuss the factors that will make mobile entertainment the largest growth area in mass media today. You should be able to explain the multi-platform workflow of transmedia, and you should understand the ways that the rapid rate of change in society is altering business models in the entertainment and media industries. I want to thank you for the time we've spent together. I've really enjoyed it. I enjoy hearing from you on the internet. I'm Catherine at CatherineClinch.com. Friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, or just get in touch with the university. But reach out and start looking at the mass media and how it affects you and what you can do to affect it. I'm Catherine Clinch, and this has been Mass Media in Society. Thanks for watching.